Lord, we pray that you will continue to have your way.
Verse 43, let's just stop right there. We're just going to stop right there.
You can be seated. You can be seated. The stern got stuck. It was immovable and began to be broken up by the waves. Now, matter of fact, can I just entertain you just one moment? There's a storm out on the ocean, and it's moving this way. There's a storm out on the ocean, and it's moving this way. If your soul is anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. If your soul's not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. Now, won't you entertain? Give the Lord a hand. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Now, because there's a little saying that goes like this, that we are in one of three categories. You are currently in a storm. There are some of you that are here this morning, you are currently in a storm. If you're not currently in a storm, you have just come out of a storm. And if you're not in one, or if you haven't just come out of one, guess what? You are headed into one.
Yeah.
Somebody say glory. You are in one of three categories. However, somebody say however. We won't, or we will not focus our time on discussing the storm aspect in the message today. Looking back at verse 40 and verse 41, where we will lift our title of the text, verse 40 says, in the scripture, and casting off the anchors. How many know that we have been told that we need to have anchors in our life to kind of hold us down, to hold us together when the storm of life is raging? We need anchors, and we're going to maybe talk about what those anchors were, what they are, what they should be. It says, they were casting off the anchors, and they left them in the sea, while at the same time they were loosening the rudders. That's the steering wheel that's in the stern, which is in the back of the boat, the real part of the boat. The rudders is the steering, the thing that stirs the boat, that causes the beam to turn. Says, while hoisting the foresail to the wind, they were heading for the beach. Verse 41, by striking a reef, which is nothing more than a buildup or a bar of sand, because they were on a beach, where two seas met, they ran the vessel aground, and the prow, which is the front of the ship, was fast and remained immovable. But the stern, which again is the rear of the ship, was broken up by the force of the waves. So the title of today's message, many of us have gone through various storms in our lives. But we want to talk about how to survive your shipwreck. How to survive your shipwreck. Because it's not in every storm. Sometimes we go through a storm. In most cases, the ship does not wreck, or the ship does not fall apart. So our safety, we are more safe in things. We can deal with the storm in a more effectively because we are in a ship and it has not broken apart. But when you're in a storm and the ship breaks apart and you have a shipwreck, it's a whole different ballgame then. Because you don't have the protection of the ship, whatever it is, the materials it's made out of, you are directly hit by the forces that come from the storm. Can you say amen?
Amen.
How to survive a shipwreck. Now, how to survive your shipwreck. Like I said, the premise of today's message, I'm just simply here to encourage you. Prior to today's text in chapter 27, Paul had been in and out of court, defending himself due to his newfound faith and because of his conversion on the Damascus Road. I know that this is going to be startling news to some of you all. Paul had just gotten saved. He was excited about being saved. Now, this is going to be startling news to some of you. When a person really gets saved, is serious for the Lord, folks just ain't gonna like you. I said, folks just ain't gonna like you. Paul said, and it brings us up to Acts 27. And Acts 20, verse number 3 says, in there, in Greece, he spent 3 months and when a plot, somebody say a plot, was formed against him by the Jews as he was about to set sail to Syria, he decided to return through Macedonia. Now, why did they devise a plot against him? I said, when you get saved and when you get sinned, you start messing with your mind. I want you to know, don't take it personal. The enemy has set a plot against you and me, against California, but now you know that we are able to survive our shipwreck. Now, why did they set a plot? Because if you go back to chapter 18, now, as I was studying and preparing for this, they were mad because he was just sharing his testimony and preaching the gospel. In chapter 18, two of the leaders had gotten saved, and then Paul stood before Galileo, and he began to defend himself, and they got upset because God set him free. You know, when God began to bless you and you, you folks just ain't gonna want you. But that's okay. That's okay. Somebody said, that's okay. You know, as long as the Lord, if God be for us, he's more than the whole world against us. So now we find ourselves at the point in his life, Paul does in his journey in chapter 27 here, where this portion of the trip spans 14 days. Chapter 27 covers 14 days, 2 weeks. He was on this journey. He had, it was 14 days, 2 weeks. They were hungry. It was cold. It was winter time. It was in the winter time. You can see that down in verse a little later. Paul was a prisoner. Verse 1 tells us that. He was on this ship with 276 people. Other prisoners, including the crew, it was a total of 276 other people on the ship totally. So it was a pretty good sized ship to carry 276 people, plus the cargo. They had the gear, the cargo. Let me highlight a few things, so just before we go on a little further. It spanned 2 weeks, they were hungry. And like I said, it was winter time. Being in a storm does not, like I said, automatically mean that you would have a shipwreck. A storm and a shipwreck are two different things. So then, just what is a shipwreck? I'm glad you asked. A shipwreck is when everything in your life is turned upside down. I know we had a powerful message. I know the pastor has been preaching powerful messages, especially the one last week. Strong faith, strong finish. But I just want to let you know that, you know, before we get to that finish, we may encounter a few more shipwrecks. And we need to know how to survive. So a shipwreck is when everything in your life is turned upside down and nothing makes sense. There's chaos, there's pain, especially emotional pain. There's confusion everywhere. It's where everything that you thought that you had and that you could depend on for security is no longer there. So in 2 Corinthians 4:8-9, it says, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. We are cast down, but not destroyed. Like I said, a shipwreck is when everything in your life is turned upside down and nothing makes sense. But the Bible said that if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Well, the Bible also said that the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and that the righteous can run into it and find safety. But not in all of them I had a shipwreck, but now in a couple of them I had a shipwreck. And I thank God that I'm still standing today, that I did testify like Paul did, that I survived my shipwreck. So now let's just walk down through here. Let's look at a couple of these verses. In verse number 8 in chapter 27, in verse number 8 in chapter 27, 8 and 9, in my version, it says, and with difficulty sailing past, they came to a place of fair havens. And this is what Paul told them. They have sailed, but they got there through difficulty. that the voyage will certainly be with damage now and with great loss. He said, I perceive. How do you thank God for the Holy Ghost? Though it may be your situation may have turned from difficult to dangerous, but the Holy Ghost is able to give you insight.
Caesar.
ship hit the reef and it began to break up, the Bible said that the men were going to kill all the prisoners. But then the centurion said, no, don't do that. All those that can swim, let them get in the water and swim. Right. And the other ones that can't swim, let them grab hold of the part and piece of the boat that they can float to safety. Yeah. I don't know about you, but there's a thing. You may not be able to swim. Right. You may not have the strength to stroke in your faith this morning. But the rest in God.
We say.
ship tonight. God is a deliverer. God will turn around. Though I've been shipwrecked, I'm going to find your peace on the broken ship and float and make my way to shore. Because God is depending on you. He's depending on me. What God wants to do with you and what he wants to do with me is put our life on display and say, look at what I can do. And a life that will trust me. A life that will trust me. A life that will hold on. Somebody say, glory to God. Glory to God. They cast down 4 anchors. I believe 1 anchor was confidence. Another anchor was their faith. Another anchor was prayer. In order to survive, you must pray and not panic. But the last anchor, I believe it was praise. Somebody say, glory to God. I'm going to praise God. Oh, yeah.
Everywhere.
that your turnaround is closer than it appears. Just look in that mirror when the enemy begins to speak to you on the passenger side of your car. These objects are closer than they appear. Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, we want you to come. If you want it,